IVM. Hi, I'm Zarina Poonawalla, a life coach, a business mentor, and a motivational speaker. I tackle the challenges that come with varied work cultures, and I try to give out some cheat codes for loving your job in the second season of the Empowering series with me, Zarina. This show will feature live sessions with me and a participant, most likely to be an entrepreneur, a startup founder, an employee, a recruiter, or just about anyone who strives to love their job and looks forward to bringing in a positive shift at their workplace. Hello and welcome to the Empowering series with me, Zarina. On today's episode, I have with me a very beautiful and dynamic woman. Although we've had few interactions, I've always been awestruck and inspired by her. She is an author and has penned 9 books. She has not defeated cancer just once, but twice, and she is cancer-free now. She is the most dignified, determined, and dynamic woman I have met, and that is Neelam Kumar. Hi, Neelam. Thank you for being on the show with us today.
Hi, Zarina. What a wonderful introduction.
Oh, well, it's all true.
And I'm so honored to be here with you today.
Thank you. Thank you for coming, and thank you for actually helping people feel empowered, because the Empowering series is all about inspiration, stories, journeys, and I couldn't think of anyone better than you.
Wow.
You know, I have followed your journey, and I've had the privilege of knowing you a little back in
Absolutely, the day, right? Zarina.
And Neelam, it's amazing how many challenges and struggles you've probably faced, but you've done it all with a smile, and you've always looked so calm and composed through this entire process. So let's start with understanding, how did this entire journey for you begin?
Zarina, I was actually offered a horror script of a life story. So, you know, widowhood at 35, financial challenges, single parenting, ostracization from society, because I'm sorry to say, even now in the, you know, places where I was living then, small towns, widows don't find it easy. So all those challenges, plus the challenge of shaking off the label of poor widow,
right,
and emerging as a strong, capable professional. That is something that was topmost on my mind, because the worst thing I thought for me was if anybody pitied me. I wanted to absolutely prove that I'm more than, you know, people think I am. And that's how the smile was there always. And I trudged my way through the mess. And, well, the tunnel was very dark. But, you know, the first cancer, that came at 1996. And then when the children were grown up and I was, I left Steel Authority of India Limited in a very top position as DGM Corporate Affairs. And I said, now I'm going to sit back and relax. You know what happened? Cancer struck again. So the only way out was to face it, not crumble.
Absolutely. So you actually, like you said, the tunnel was really dark, but that you did find light at the end of it.
Absolutely.
But the concept of coming up with books, was this part of the cancer journey? Was this part of the widow journey? Or was this just part of Neelam's journey?
Ah, that's such a beautiful question, Zarina. You know, books have always been a part of my life, the reading and writing of it. So earlier, when I mean, I now cringe when I read my first book, because it was so naive, so raw. It was a love story. And I guess I was just dreaming of things that probably are not humanly possible. But then the I always say, Zarina, a very strange thing. The best thing that ever happened to me was cancer. So when cancer struck me a second time, I decided that my writing would have to change.
Okay. You mean the quality of content?
Of content, everything would happen to, you know, it would have to be turned on its head.
Right.
I now would not write fiction. I decided to write what life is all about. So, Zarina, you know, I've always been a reader of books. So, on my chemotherapy table, I was listening to people screaming in pain, and I said, what do I read to inspire myself? And I picked up Grit and Grace, She Dies. I picked up Tuesdays with Maury, He Dies.
Oh, yes.
I picked up all these books, and I saw Anand sometime later, and He Dies. I said, hello, what's happening? I'm not ready to die. And then I realized in India, there are no happy books on cancer.
Oh, yes.
And
that's so true.
Yeah, isn't it?
It is.
So then I wrote To Cancer with Love, My Journey of Joy. It was a very happy story of an alter ego. And all I had to do was just follow that script.
How beautiful. No, but the concept of writing about cancer with a happy mindset, is that hard?
Well, when you are right in the thick of it, there are two things that can happen to you. You can either go around moaning and groaning and making others' lives miserable also, or you can conduct yourself in a very dignified manner.
Absolutely.
So I decided to be the latter, and I quickly jumped from the victim to the victor mode.
How beautiful.
And I also, Zarina, realized that the second time that the cancer has come, it means that the universe is trying to tell me something.
Right.
And it just means that I'm here on a mission to help others through their dark tunnels. Remember the dark tunnel?
Yes, of course, of course.
And so this book became a huge bestseller. Mm-hmm. So then I realized that people are quite sick of Sas Bahu Rona Dhona, and so they want a happy
ending. Yeah, the melodramas.
Yeah. So I followed it up with a graphic novel version, To Cancer with Love, a graphic novel. And I'm a sea of possibilities.
That's a book I really love.
Have you read that?
Yes, I have.
Oh, thank you.
I absolutely love how you've depicted your narratives. I really like it. And I mean, it's very positive. It's so inspiring.
How lovely. And I'm so grateful that legends like Mr. Amitabh Bachchan and Mr. Ratan Tata, they stepped forward to support this project.
Right.
So for me, Zarina, it has been truly a journey of joy because if through my writing, I have been able to bring a little joy, a little courage into people's lives, I think my life's purpose is somewhat solved.
Yes.
And the recent book, the biography of Manisha Koirala, Healed, How Cancer Gave Me a New Life, that has also become a very big bestseller, and it's helping a lot of people. That gives me a lot of joy.
And the fact that Manisha and you both have gone through this journey.
Yes.
Right? Must have made it very, very overwhelming as...
Absolutely.
You know, an experience to be able to write about it.
Absolutely. It was, you know, a survivor to survivor thing. I sort of understood exactly what she had been through. And that is why I think, you know, I consider this book, Healed, to be my best writing to date. Because I just stood back and took an objective view of the person, and the best came out of me.
How beautiful. It's just so nice to be able to speak to somebody about cancer so openly and with a positive mindset. You know, everybody's constantly telling us about the troubles, the challenges, the trials.
Absolutely.
No one's telling us how to overcome them.
Yeah. So, Zarina, I'm going to share with you something I feel very strongly about.
Please do.
So, you see, I've been through breast cancer twice. And I have seen the many... I've been very distressed by the kind of myths, superstitions surrounding the breast. So, you know, there's a lot of shame that is drilled into Indian women about this organ. And therefore, they, especially in the rural areas, they don't talk about anything that has happened to their breast. And also, I feel that women, in Indian women, they are glorified so much as the, you know, sacrificing Savitri, perfect Indian woman, that they keep their own health at the lowest priority in the family hierarchy. So even if they get that funny feeling in their breast, they will wait to tell before telling anyone. They will wait for their husband's schedules, demands, routines to be met, their son's board exams to be done, sure. the daughter's marriage to be over. And then, only then they will reluctantly take themselves
address
to a doctor.
Address their issue.
Yeah.
yeah.
By that time, it becomes too late.
Too late.
You know,
yeah.
and that's where I feel really, really sorry. Because this lack of awareness about yourself is so dangerous. It's a patriarchal death trap.
It is.
And, you know, the surprising thing is that both breast cancer and cervical cancer are completely curable if they are caught in the first stage. So to all the men who are listening to this podcast, my appeal is please be macho enough to take the woman inside your home out for her cancer screening.
Right.
Please do.
That is actually quite true. And I suppose we have addressed issues such as periods in recent times. It's coming out in the open, when, like you mentioned, you know.
Yes.
The organs which are not glorified on a woman's body or looked at from a very sexual perspective.
Absolutely.
They haven't been understood as to be part of the basic human anatomy.
Absolutely.
Right? And period is a thing people are discussing these days.
Yes.
Slightly more open. We have Akshay Kumar doing a film and, you know, whatnot.
Yes.
But you just mentioned something which I wouldn't have imagined talking about, Neelam, because breast cancer being looked at from this perspective, I didn't know this was possible. So I'm so glad you're addressing this.
Thank you, Zarina. I think it's my life's mission to raise awareness.
Right.
In fact, people were so stunned when, you know, at a time I had post chemotherapy, I had no hair, no eyelashes, no eyebrows. But I thought it, you know, I thought that it is my duty to go up on stage and talk about my illness.
Of course.
Boldly, so that women could come out of that so-called shame that they were surrounded with. And once we start talking about it, only then can we selfishly seek options.
Yes, yes, absolutely. Agreed.
And the other thing, Zarina, you know, it's so strange and quite hilarious, actually. Mm-hmm. People do not know what to say to a person who is stricken or suffering.
Oh, yes.
In all their, you know, best intentions, our bedside etiquette is horrible. People would come to me and they would say, oh, ma'am, it was wonderful knowing you.
Yeah.
I would look at them and I'd say, hey, hello, where am I going? I'm going to outlive you, sir.
You've actually had people coming to your bedside and saying that to you?
Absolutely. And, you know, there's the other kind who would come and sob and cry. And they say, my nani ki dadi ki chaji ki behen, wo, she was also as brave as you. But in the end, you know what happened? She died. And then that with a big sigh. And they'd say, but be brave, be brave. And then there was the other kind, Zarina, who would say, you know, what will you do? It's your karma catching up
from
your past life.
No. I hope that. No. That is too much.
And they actually kill you with their kindness.
I know. So what is it, Neelam, that would actually be comforting at the bedside of
a
patient? Yes, because I think it's important. I'm pretty sure we all go through that moment. You know, even to this day, sometimes going to a funeral can be quite a dilemma.
Yes.
You don't know what to say. You don't know how to approach this situation. And the worst is when, like you mentioned, being on someone's bedside. So the bedside etiquette, I hope it's none of the three, because I'm pretty sure all three are really crass in the way they come across. Huh?
Absolutely. You know, I really think the best bedside etiquette when you come to a patient who is trying to be brave is not to speak. You know, that's a moment when words should, you know, when we are in the deepest of emotions, a mother will call a child, aja beta, aja beta. But when the child comes to her, she will just hug him. No more words are required.
Sure.
So that's a time when actions, not words, should speak. A simple hug, just being there, that is all. You know, you should give the patient the confidence that you will stand by her or him.
Right. It's so nicely put, actually. I think listeners should pay attention to this little bedside etiquette tip we just got from you, Neelam, because I'm sure we all need it at some point.
Absolutely.
And if you are in that position, that's what you want to listen to.
Absolutely.
You just probably need a little empathy and a little
so right.
unsaid compassion.
Unsaid compassion and right? empathy. Yes,
yeah,
that is exactly. And, you know, no melodrama,
oh,
please.
Yes.
I mean, unfortunately, we are doomsday predictors.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
you
yes.
know, so we like to tell people, you know, people who are suffering, we like to tell them all negative things. And we are, you know, at some point, I feel we are actually a very pessimistic society where we think cancer ho gaya, ye to mar jayega. But it's not like that at all. Cancer is not a death sentence. And that is something I want to tell people through this podcast.
Mm-hmm.
Now with the modern you know, medicines,
right.
it is curable or manageable.
Yes.
Yes. So we can be their cheerleaders
mm-hmm.
instead of doomsday predictors.
Right. I believe it's just the stigma around cancer for
right.
the many, many years that we have
mm-hmm.
seen. You know,
I must
through
talk
history.
Talking about stigma.
Yes.
It's terrible because I have met, you know, my books are my windows to people's hearts, and I feel so blessed because they come to me and talk to me about their problems.
Mm-hmm.
And as you know, I'm also an adversity coach.
Right.
So I handhold and take people through their problem, whatever their problem is. And I have met a woman mm-hmm. who told me that her husband, of course, this was, she was a village woman.
Mm-hmm.
And she said her husband had thrown her out of the house because he said she had caught the infection of cancer from somewhere.
So? Mm-hmm.
And promptly he got a younger, more beautiful woman. So you see, it's a social evil.
It is. Mm-hmm. And it is a social evil where people need to be educated.
Absolutely.
Enlightened.
Absolutely.
As to why this doesn't need to be treated the way we treat it as a society.
Yes.
Especially if you're talking about breast cancer now.
Yes.
At this point in time, I'm focusing on breast cancer
yes.
as a topic.
Yes.
Not every cancer, but especially when it comes to women, it
mm-hmm.
comes to, you just have to be there, you know.
Yes.
Like I said, that unsaid compassion. And it doesn't
Absolutely.
Have to, doesn't have to even be only through that male member in the family.
Absolutely.
It must be through everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And what do you think are the three more most important things, let's say, Neelam, that a cancer patient or
mm-hmm.
a person going through the process
mm-hmm.
of chemo, radiations
mm-hmm.
and things, what are the three key things that they probably would like coming from people around them?
Well, I think, you know, what I missed,
mm-hmm.
I mean, that's why I wrote the book.
Mm-hmm.
Humor is something
yes.
that we completely overlook. And breaking the stereotype
mm-hmm.
of a cancer patient looking like someone that people think they should look like.
Sure.
And the third would be absolutely welcoming that person
mm-hmm.
as somebody who, you know, we would welcome somebody who has flu or whatever
right.
and knowing that person will absolutely get over it, and the person will.
Right.
So I found this lack of humor, you know, was so lacking at that time that I used to, you know, laugh at myself. I used to say, all
mm-hmm.
right, I don't have hair. I don't have eyebrows. I don't have eyelashes. Maybe I'll go and I'll audition for a science fiction movie. I'm looking like an alien.
So,
you know,
sweet.
Yeah, when you can laugh at your situation,
right.
I think you can activate the pharmaceutical industry inside your body.
Mm.
And you can trigger the happiness. Where did I pick this up from? You know, I met a very powerful philosophy,
mm-hmm.
which is Nichiren Buddhism.
Mm-hmm.
And that taught me that, you know, I can rewrite my own destiny.
Right.
And that is how, with the chanting of Namyoho Renge Kyo, I knew that I could become the architect. And that, you know, made me jump from being a victim to
mm-hmm.
a victor.
Right. And that is so beautiful because it's hard for people to even imagine being an architect of their own lives. It's hard, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, as a coach, I'm pretty sure you have such people,
yes.
clients coming to you. I've had a client
mm-hmm.
in recent times who
yes.
was faced with cancer.
Uh-huh.
And in fact, that's the reason I asked you, what
yes.
is it that you would like to, like you mentioned humor.
Yeah.
So maybe two more from
yeah.
you.
Okay.
But the reason I asked you is, it was more difficult for me to coach the people around my client
yes.
as to how they need to treat the situation as compared to my client. My client was full of willpower, positivity and persistence and knew that he's going to get out of this.
Yes.
But the people around him made him feel like he's already
dead, under.
He's in the grave already. And, you know, there's crying, there's drama. Of course, we understand the human emotions.
Right.
But people don't know how, they are not equipped, I guess.
Exactly. So right? Before I answer... the other two things.
Right.
I would like to tell you that when I was on my hospital bed, it requires long hours and you're only looking up at the ceiling, which is empty and bland and blank, which I feel hospitals should actually put up all their paintings on the ceilings because that's the view that the patients get.
Right.
It should be cheerful, more cheerful. I decided that an intelligent person needs his mind to be engaged.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I wrote, India's first personal growth and coloring workbook. So that is something, the coloring takes you back to your own childhood. It connects you to the child in you and it engages your mind completely. And the journaling, the workbook, you can work through your fears, anxieties. And that's not for patients only. That's for the caregivers who are sitting outside and waiting for hours and hours.
Right.
So that's a very important tool. I think emotional empowerment, you know, we have medicines for cancer.
Yes.
But very little is being done for emotional empowerment. And that's where my books have stepped in. That's
Absolutely.
The gap that my books have filled in.
I know. I can imagine because, you know, we're talking about something as we call it the Big C.
Yes.
Right. It's recently been announced as the Big C. I read the Big C when I saw one of Sonali Bendre's interviews.
Yes. Yes.
And that's when that word kind of resonated.
Right.
And why are we calling it that big?
Mm,
if
exactly.
you want to deal with it,
exactly.
like you're, of course it is very big. Of course it is traumatic.
Mm-hmm.
The experience is vicious, definitely.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, if you want to deal with even the biggest mountain, as long as I don't know how tall the mountain is, I'm going to take a step at a time, right?
Very true, very true.
So I don't want to calculate the height of that mountain and then decide, oh, it's so big.
True, true.
Right?
So I really feel, you know, that cancer is the best thing that happened to my life. Because, Zarina, when you have seen death that closely, you truly begin appreciating life. And that's when I decided that my remaining days, which are going to be forever, I'm going to live on even beyond my physical body because my books are there. 9 of them are there and the 10th I'm writing.
All right. That's lovely.
So these are going to be, my books are my cheerleaders for all the people who will be facing everything. And I want to say they should feel that every obstacle is actually an opportunity.
True. True. If you see an obstacle as an opportunity, then you'll be able to sculpt the life
absolutely
that you want,
yes.
right? As per the way you want to create your own destiny.
Absolutely.
No disease is big enough
true.
For us
true.
To fight. I think apart from death, there's nothing at this point in time that's certain with us.
And I think it's the attitude.
All right.
Attitude is something that is in your hands.
So shall I take that as the second?
Yes, that's
humor?
The second. Humor, correct attitude and the right people.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. These three things, if you surround yourself with lots of humor, the right attitude and people who will become your cheerleaders instead of people who will be your detractors and give you sob stories.
Mm-hmm.
You know, surround yourself with positivity and you will become a positive person.
That's true.
These three are very important.
Wonderful. On that note, Neelam, let's take a quick break.
Sure.
And we'll see you on the other side of the break.
Sure.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to another awesome week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you're not following us on social media, please make sure you do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. I also kind of wanted to make a couple of other announcements, right? So first, as I think I mentioned last week, I just want to kind of reiterate, we're going to be closing our SoundCloud channel at the end of this month. So if this is where you're hearing us, please maybe try and listen to us on something else, maybe the IVM Podcast app, maybe another app. We're on all kinds of different platforms. The other thing is a little happier, right? So for the first time ever in Asia, we have a podcasting award for shows made in Asia. And we're very happy to announce that a number of our shows have been nominated. Pesa Vesa, Tech Careers in the New, Vartala, Lab and Shunya One have all been nominated for these awards. Please go to the website asianpodcastawards.com and go vote for our shows. Come on, make us win, guys. And let me tell you what's going on this week. On the Seen and the Unseen, Amit is joined by China expert Manoj Kewalramani. They talk about the China-India relationship and conflicts that need to be resolved. On Varta Lab, Akash and Naveen are joined by writer, director and producer Raj Kaushal. Raj is an old friend of mine and he talks to these guys about Jim Jam, biscuits, Kiss Me Dogs and cricket. Speaking of cricket on What a Player, Mikhail and Siddharth talk about the India-South Africa Test Series. They also discuss the Japanese Formula One and announce the What a Player of the Week and Not a Player of the Week, also known as the Wow Now. Let's talk about what's happening in the pop culture side of things. On the Geek Fruit podcast, hosts Dinkar and Tejas are joined by their friends Kunal Rao from the East India Company. Join them as they discuss their favorite sitcoms of all time. On Mr. and Mrs. Binge Watch, Janice and Anirudh continue the saga of Indian shows that they love. Tune into the second part where they discuss the TV shows Family Man and Ye Meri Family. On Football Shootball, hosts Gaurav, Karthik and Shiva talk about the biggest rivalry in English football and how it's become more of a walkover than a competition. On Paperback, Satyajit and Rachita are joined by Natasha Malpani Oswal, the host of another IVM show, Boundless. She discusses her love for writing along with the creative process she practices every day. On Keeping It Queer, Naveen and Farad are joined by our producer Madhuri Advani to understand asexuality and bust the myths surrounding this umbrella category. With that, let's get you onto your show.
Welcome back to the Empowering Series with me, Zarina, and we're still in conversation with Neelam Kumar. So, Neelam, thank you for being on the show and giving us such amazing thoughts and inspiration on cancer so far, right? We've talked about
the
cancer.
The pleasure is all mine, Zarina.
It's amazing because I think all the things, the stigmas and the challenges or the turmoils that you've talked about,
yes,
they are essential in today's society to understand and to be addressed.
Absolutely.
Moving on from there, I'd like to ask you something which is slightly more personal. I mean, of course, we're talking about your personal journey, but
yes,
even more.
Yes.
So what was that one defining moment in life where you went from this timid, young, dependent girl to this unflinching, independent woman? And not to forget, you've also been a mother of two. Mm-hmm. So how has this journey been for you, that moment?
I think my, you know, the last words which I will say to the maker is, what a beautiful life you gave me. Mm-hmm. Because you gave me a chance to polish myself and to bring, hopefully, a better person out of whatever you made me. So, you know, my one defining moment, Zarina, not many people know that my parents, they took me to Russia, the erstwhile Russia, and therefore my primary school education was in the Russian language.
Oh, lovely.
So I did not know English at all.
Is that so?
So when I returned to India, when they put me into a fancy convent school, you know, teachers called me wood sitting on wood because I was so dull. And they said, this girl will never be able to learn the English language. And then I grew up and I studied all that string of degrees that you see was done in some kind of a zid. And
To prove,
I suppose. Right. And when I went, I got my scholarship to go to the USA to do my master's in journalism. And I think the first time when I topped in a foreign country and when the award for journalism was being given to me and when I actually stood up on stage and I was speaking to, I was speaking in English to an English speaking audience, I think that was one moment that was so beautiful. And I said, oh my goodness, I totally feel empowered, which is the name of your series.
So sweet, yes. But such an astonishing moment for you.
Absolutely.
Defining, really.
That
defining.
Was a defining moment because it gave me the courage to do so much more. I knew that now I would be giving back to society. And, you know, I came back to writing and that's how I started writing. And, of course, each book that came out was its own defining moment. It's like a childbirth.
Sure.
And since you've talked about my children, I have been blessed with two wonderful children, Abhilasha Razdan, who's married to the most wonderful Abhishek Razdan, and my precious son, Raj Neel Kumar, mm-hmm. who's married to the beautiful Manshi Kumar.
So sweet.
And I have a beautiful grandchild whose name is Rajveer. He's my heartthrob.
Lucky grandchild you have.
I think I'm lucky.
He's got the coach. Yeah, he's got an in-house coach. And a grandma with so many books to her credit.
That he's so already beautiful. Started writing. He's a baby.
It's so nice to see someone grow out of their adversity and then be able to hold hands.
Absolutely.
Help someone through this whole process. Because it's nice when people realize that all of this is normal. You
yes.
have to face all of these
yes,
things in life.
Yes,
there's
yes.
nothing. There's nothing extraordinary.
You know,
your journey is.
You do a lot of that yourself, Zarina. You are a coach yourself.
That's right, yes.
So how do you coach your clients through adversity?
That's a very good question. I haven't been asked that on the show. Through adversity, I think what a person requires coaching for is to understand their purpose.
True.
Adversities are coming in. It's part of everybody's journey.
Absolutely.
So it may be in the form of a disease.
Yes.
Or a financial crunch.
Yes.
Or a heartbreak.
Absolutely.
A bad relationship.
Absolutely.
You know, something sour. But there is adversity in everything.
Absolutely.
And in those moments of adversity,
yes.
like you said, you know, instead of looking at yourself as a victim,
mm-hmm.
I help them to look at themselves as victors.
Wonderful,
so,
Zarina. We need more people like you,
so
honestly.
Sweet. Thank you.
You know, I also feel that every person on this earth
mm-hmm.
is in search of happiness.
Oh, absolutely.
But happiness is not a life without problems.
Right.
It is a life in which you have the ability and the tools to overcome those problems.
Correct.
So, you know, when I do life skills coaching, I'm currently looking after, you know, 11th and 12th standard students mm-hmm. in Aran Podar school. They go through every issue and it's all in 70 mm, because when you're a teenage,
yes.
everything becomes very dramatic. So, you know, I sort of handhold them through their problems and show them you can overcome this. It's not the end of the world.
Absolutely. And how do you now, since you've mentioned, because
yes.
I do have that age group myself,
wonderful.
You know, a couple of them.
Wonderful.
In fact, I've had kids with me since they were 13 and now they're in universities and, you know, they're still with me. They will still tell me.
They are so fortunate to have you.
So sweet. But I've always mentioned that mm-hmm. teenagers are a Pandora's box.
Yes.
If you really know how to tap into their potential.
Absolutely.
But then again, Neelam, there is the challenge of the intolerance, impatience, restlessness.
Mm-hmm.
How do you deal with that as a coach?
So, you know, I think teenage is a very thorny crown to wear.
True.
Everyone wants to be young, you know, but it's not easy to be young at this point in life. There's so much of academic pressure, peer pressure, distractions.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, first of all, to calm the person down.
Mm-hmm.
You know, today's teenagers are sleep deprived, food deprived, love deprived. They're deprived of everything.
Everything.
All they have are these gadgets and these distractions. So to bring them to a realization that they are more than all these and their happiness will not come to them through anything external.
Right.
The moment they tap into their own inherent potential
mm-hmm.
and bring out their strength from within themselves, they already know how to handle every situation.
They are so smart and sharp.
Absolutely, absolutely.
One thing I imagine, if they could deal with well,
yes,
and
yes.
if not only them, even adults
yes.
in general could deal with,
yes.
if they can differentiate between real
mm-hmm.
validation and virtual validation.
Very good.
Right?
Absolutely.
Because everything is so virtual
yes,
in
yes,
their lives.
Yes,
and
yeah.
even the validation. So,
yes.
you know, you have 100 likes on an Instagram.
Yeah.
And somebody has 101 and you're thinking,
yeah.
you know, you're less loved.
Exactly.
So that kind of validation should
exactly.
not define
yeah.
People.
So all the modules, among the many modules that I teach them, which are all quite unique,
mm-hmm.
one of them is growing up in the digital world.
Oh, true.
And it is so heartbreaking to hear how awful their problems are. And then, you know, to bring them to a place of sanity. Because as you know, a coach's job is not to give any advice.
Yes, it's not. It really isn't.
But to help them find the solution themselves.
Yes.
And I truly enjoy, because I feel, Zarina, that I am blessed to be able to influence young India.
That is very well put. And since you've mentioned young India, I have a quirky question for you.
Sure.
Now. So you obviously have had this journey and it's made you so much more valiant, you mm-hmm. know, with time.
Mm-hmm.
And you stood strong as a mountain.
Mm-hmm.
But let's assume you were your younger self at this point. Mm-hmm. What advice would you be giving yourself? Since we're talking about younger India.
I'm going to talk about... to a young Neelam,
mm-hmm.
first of all, you will be able to speak in English, Neelam, sometime.
That is so nice.
Sometime in life, you will be able to overcome this failure and you will be able to understand that life is not a dead end.
Mm-hmm.
And also, you know, I, as a young girl, I have been extremely frightened of lizards and scorpions and anything creepy and crawly.
Is that right?
And I really thought I was a coward. Actually, I'll tell you a secret. I
yes.
still am scared of them.
Just little then, phobias.
Yeah.
Yeah, with insects.
But then when people started celebrating me as a courageous woman, I said, oh my God, what's happening? So I would tell my younger self to hold on and be brave and patient. Good times are just around the corner.
That's like I said in the beginning when I was introducing you.
Yeah.
That you are somebody who can, you're an awe-striking individual in a way.
And I love you.
So I love you too. You had something that you wanted to share with us.
You know, when I'm a bit low,
mm-hmm.
there's a song that, I mean, I can't sing, but these are some...
We'll try sing with you, not sure.
These are some lyrics that that really inspire me. And I always tell myself, this is an R. Kelly song.
Oh, yeah?
And the words are so beautiful. I believe I can fly.
Mm-hmm.
I believe I can touch the sky. I think about it every night and day. Spread my wings and fly away. I believe I can soar. I see me running through that open door. I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly. Yes, I believe I can fly.
Amazing. One of my favorite songs. I think
Isn't
everybody
it?
Is look when everyone's looking for motivation,
yes.
they want to listen to a song like that.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And visual or musical motivation
mm-hmm.
or the kind of things that we watch on television.
Yes.
It can be very helpful.
So, you know, Zarina, good you asked me that because
mm-hmm.
now, you know, of course, I'm still doing, you know, cancer writing. But now I've moved on to another genre that
okay.
is inspirational and motivational writings.
That's lovely.
So the
Tell
next
us about it.
Yeah, the next two books that will be coming out
mm-hmm.
are, you know, series. This is a tentative title. Of course, I'm going to change that. Yes, I Can Overcome Obstacles. So they brave people, stories of brave, actual, everyday heroes
mm-hmm.
who have really, really, like, you know, a man in Australia who is a double amputee.
Uh-huh.
And yet he climbed the Everest. And how? You know, then there's a woman who was gang raped, but how she has bounced back to become a celebrity.
Mm-hmm.
And again, the power of one, how one person can make an entire difference. So when people say, "Main akele kya karungi ya karunga,"
mm-hmm.
I don't believe that.
Mm-hmm.
I believe one person can definitely make a lot of difference. And that's why now my books are in the genre of identifying real life heroes
mm-hmm.
and presenting them to people to inspire them that, yes, if they can do it, you can do that too.
True, true. In fact, you know, since you mentioned one person, if you look at history
yes.
of any country, any individual, any change,
mm-hmm.
it's always taken one person
absolutely,
for
absolutely.
A revolution.
Absolutely,
and
yes.
no revolution started with 100 people.
Yes.
Always started with one
You're
person.
You're very right, Zarina.
Right?
Yes. So we have to believe in our own innate potential.
True. So true. And on that note, I'd like to ask you something very, very important.
Yes.
It's the end of the segment. And in this segment, I'd like to know, what is it that empowers you, Neelam?
What empowers me?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I have always believed a woman comes with empowerment installed in her character. And some can polish it and bring it to a shine. Some believe they can't. Therefore, they go through life dependent and unused.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Unused in soul, unused in mind, and unused in spirit.
Right.
Because, you know, adversities are so important. Because it's only when you are up against a huge obstacle, mm-hmm. only then can you test who you are.
True.
So I think a woman is already empowered. All she needs is a chance to prove that and
right.
the right opportunities.
I did talk about this on one of my other episodes
mm-hmm.
and we were in conversation. I was talking to another co-host
uh-huh.
and I said the same thing, that ironically, although this is the empowering series,
yes,
we're focusing on empowerment.
Yes.
But when we look at women, they don't
yes.
really require mm. empowerment.
Absolutely.
We have a lot within us
yes.
and all we need is the
Give
right
us
platform.
Opportunities. Yeah.
Right, a platform or the right kind of a support system,
Absolutely.
Ecosystem to nurture ourselves
Absolutely.
In.
Absolutely.
So
Absolutely.
On that note, Neelam, I'd like to end this segment and our conversation with sharing something that I truly believe in with our audience. That if you knew the significance of your life, you would never question your value. But you never know it until it's too late. And that's an utter pity.
Wow.
So it's better that you stop pitying yourselves.
Absolutely.
And turn yourselves into triumphful human beings.
Absolutely.
Going back to stating what you mentioned, you know, victims to victors,
yes,
basically.
Yes.
And on that note, thank you so much, Neelam, for joining me on the show. It was such a pleasure to have you on the Empowering
what
series.
What a pleasure being here, speaking to you, and through you to this whole wonderful audience.
Thank you, Neelam. You were remarkable, commendable, and I hope you truly keep inspiring people like you
thank
are.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
If you liked this podcast, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM Network. You can listen to us on the IVM Podcast app or ivmpodcast.com. You can also follow us on our social media. We are at IVM Podcasts on Twitter and Instagram.
Hello, everyone. I'm Zane.
I'm Avanti.
And welcome back to a brand new season of Marbles Lost and Found.
A show on mental health and its stigma. And we're kind of making it an open conversation.
Pretty much, yeah. And we're really, really excited about this season because we have a number of guests on and we'll be talking about things like addiction,
grief, children and mental health.
Exactly, children and mental health. And our listeners have also written in
yeah,
this time. Yes,
and we have an episode dedicated to that.
Yes, and guys, thank you so much for writing and we really, really appreciate it.
And we're really excited for you to tune in on Tuesdays on the IVM website or app or wherever you get your podcasts from.
And you can find Marbles Lost and Found on Facebook or you can find Marbles Lost and Found on Instagram as well. The handle being Marbles Podcast India.
Can't wait for you to tune in.
Thank you very much. See you guys soon.
How many times have you motivated yourself to improve your sleep? Or lose weight, or be more productive? How many times have you failed? Hi, my name is Ashton Doctor. Tune into my show, The Habit Coach Podcast, where we focus on creating small, tiny habits to improve your life instead of those big, impossible tasks. So make listening to me a habit every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday on the IVM Podcast app or ivmpodcast.com or on your favorite podcasting app.